So going now from questions about dreams, let us now get busy in learning the Ten Commandments as we have started 2 weeks ago. Last week, somehow, our lecture was deviated to a fascinating subject regarding the four rabbis who went into the Pardes. Remember last week? We learned about four great rabbis who went into the garden of learning, exploring the Torah in its four facets, the Pshat, the Remez, the Sod, and the Drash. And that was the lecture of last week. But now we return to the idea, because I think it is very, very important to learn, at least superficially, the Ten Commandments, which people think they know, but they don't know really. The Ten Commandments should be learned. It is very possible to consecrate months of study on the Ten Commandments, because as I mentioned already once before, that each one of the Ten Commandments is a foundation. Remember, the Ten Commandments are not any different than the rest of the 613 commandments of the Torah. The only thing is, why were they assembled in Ten Commandments? Because they are a foundation which represents an untold number of other ordinances and observances. Which means there is ground for learning each one of those Ten Commandments in depth. And of course, depending on our level, and there is a way to learn it on each kind of level. We are going to learn it in a so-called superficial manner, but enough for us to absorb the idea of the Ten Commandments. If you remember, 2 weeks ago we started with the first commandment. And the first commandment says, Anochi Hashem Elokecha. It is in fact not a commandment. It looks like not a commandment. Rather, it is a statement. I am God, your God, who took you out of Egypt. Asher Otziacha Me'eretz Mitzrayim. If you remember, we said, what kind of commandment is this? This is apparently only a statement. So there are two ways how we can learn this. Number one, the Rambam. Maimonides says that this is the first commandment, is a commandment, even though it sounds like a statement, but it is a commandment that requires from each and every Jew to believe in God. Chayav Adam le'amin b'Shem. One is under the obligation to believe in the Almighty. And what kind of God? Don't you say I believe in God and you mean one of the religions? It has to be the God who took us out from Egypt. See, this way you don't confuse yourself with Christianity or Islam or Buddhism. All of them, they say, of course we believe in God, but that's the kind of God that to which we do not turn. We turn to only the God of Israel, who is the God who has liberated us from Egypt. Which is the reason, if you remember, we mentioned the question, why is it that it says, Anochi Hashem Elokecha, I am God, your God, who took you out from Egypt. Isn't this better to say, I am God who created you? Don't you think that creation is a greater miracle than the liberation from Egypt? But we answer that if he said, I am God who created you, then we wouldn't know which God is it. Because he created all mankind, and therefore everyone will be under the obligation to turn to him. But who? So each one will go his way thinking that that's his God. Therefore, the Bible makes it clear. I am God, your God, who took you out of Egypt. A God who did not take you from Egypt is not God. See, I don't know what the Christians or the other religions do with this statement. What do they do? The only thing that they can say is, they are the real Jews. In which way is it that they are the real Jews? I mean, Jews today, even when they are not religious, they still know that their language is the Hebrew language, which is the language of the Torah. So in which way the other nations can say and pretend that they are the real Jews? But that's, and by the way, another question to which we can return one of these days. And the truth is that it's so clear how happy we are. Ashrenu matov chelkenu umanaim goralenu. How happy we are that we were born Jews. At least we have no confusion. We have absolutely nothing that is not clear. It's all there. Anochi Hashem Elokecha, which God? The one who took you out from Egypt. How do we know that we went out from Egypt? It's a very easy answer to this question. Very, very easy question to answer. How do we know that we are the religion that turns to the real God because He took us out of Egypt? How do we know that we came out from Egypt? It's very simple. Do you celebrate Pesach? Yes. We all celebrate Pesach. We all read the Haggadah. And we all tell the story. As they told us thousands of years ago, 3,200 years ago, that every year we should take up the 14th of Nisan in the night when we celebrate Pesach and read the Haggadah to narrate the story of Egypt. Show me one nation that does it, except the Jewish people. Only the Jewish people does it since time immemorial. So don't you think it's a very easy proof that we are the nation of Israel? I mean, if they say they are the ones, then why don't you celebrate Pesach? Why don't you read the Haggadah? We read the Haggadah as it was told since time immemorial. We still have the books today that we study every day, that were the same books that were 2,000 and 2,500 years ago. The same books and the same Torah, which is 3,200 years ago. The same Torah never changed. But they came up with all kinds of different Torahs, different Bibles, the Second Testament, the New Testament.
160,000 New Testaments.
Yeah. Let them say whatever they want. All we know is that by us it's very clear. We don't need any confusing things. It's all clear. The Bible says, I am God, your God, who took you out from Egypt. So don't make any mistakes. You know that you are the people of Israel because you celebrate Pesach. Therefore you know that a long time ago your ancestors came out from Egypt. That's the reason why you read the Haggadah. You tell the story to your children and grandchildren. Every generation we read the Haggadah. So you see that we are the people that came out from Egypt. I mean, even Olmert, the Rosh HaMemshala, I mean the Prime Minister of Israel, who hardly knows that he is a Jew, maybe yes or not. No, he's a Jew, not such a good one. But he reads the Haggadah? So if he does, that's a definite testimony to the fact that we are the real Am Israel. So therefore, we glorify who? The God of Israel, who took us out from Egypt. That's the only God. The rest is only all kinds of inventions that the nations had to invent to themselves. Why? Why did they have to invent to themselves? If you remember the last lectures, we did demonstrate to you that all the world heard with their own ears the day when God gave the Torah to the people of Israel. All they had to do was to decide, to make their choice, and to leave, and to join the people of Israel. Exactly like Yitro, remember the father-in-law of Moshe? He also had a big decision to make, to leave everything behind, to leave his position as the high priest of Midian, to leave his riches, to leave everything, and to join the people of Israel. But only him, he is the only exception, and the rest of the world didn't. Why? Does that mean that they did not believe? No, they believed that this is the truth. Only they couldn't take it. It was not easy for them to, not, as I said, if you remember, to give up on food, any kind of food, to, you know, the laws of kashrut, even though we are proud to say that we are kosher and we eat only kosher things. But the nations, it's very hard for them. It's very tough for them to fast once a year or twice or six times a year like we do. It's not easy for them to separate from their wives every 2 weeks, every month. You know, it's not easy for them to go to the synagogue whether it rains or it snows or whatever is the weather is, and yet you have to go to the synagogue and you put your tefillin. It's not easy to go and buy a mezuzah for $100 or $50 or so. It's not easy to buy a tefillin for $1,000, and yet Jews do it gladly, and that's their life, that's our glory. But they knew that to become a Jew is going to require from them so many things, so They said, sorry, maktiv ba, what is it that's written there? So Hashem says, this is what's written. Oh, that we cannot. So that's the reason why the nations had no choice but to invent their own belief, to invent their own religion. When by us it's so clear, even a child will understand who is the real religion. Anochi Hashem Elokecha, the first commandment. You know, the Christians also have the first commandment. I don't know what they do with the continuation of that commandment. The Asher Hotzeticha Me'eretz Mitzrayim, the one who took you out from Egypt. I really don't know what they do with that when they read it. You know what happened? That's the reason why they ignored the First Testament, the Old Testament, the Bible, the real Bible, and they invented their own. And their own doesn't have any Ten Commandments. They had only what they wanted to have there, and that's it. I'm not saying anything about their. I don't care about their religion. I respect whatever they want me to respect. I'm willing to respect them because we have no choice. We have to live in this planet. So therefore we have to respect them, we have to be polite, we have to show them. But chas v'shalom, at the same time, we have to be ready to give our life rather than to relinquish our faith. Why is that? The first commandment. There is nothing clearer than that. The first commandment comes in such a clear way. I am God, your God. Just in case you will be looking for some God or some other invention, remember, I am the God. Not who created you, that everybody knows, but who took you out from Egypt. There is only one nation that came out from Egypt after 210 years of rough slavery, for which we celebrate Pesach and our freedom every year, for the last 3,200 years. Who can come and tell me we are wrong? In fact, that's what I am going now. If you ask me a question, so the Rambam said that the Ten Commandment, the first commandment, Anochi, is the mitzvah of emunah, is the precept, the obligation to believe. So anybody can come and ask, but how can I convince myself? How can I fulfill the mitzvah of emunah, of faith? And what about if I don't believe? What can I do? I mean, show me. There were many times people who asked this question. You want me to believe in your God? Show me your God. I did tell you this story, I think, sometime in the past. When the Emperor Caesar himself, he called upon Rabbi Yehoshua ben Hanania, one of the great sages of the Talmud, and he asked him, if you say that you have a God, I don't believe in a God that I don't see. I believe only in a God that I see. Show me your God, and then I will believe in it. So the rabbi did not lose his marbles, and he says, Majesty, no problem. You want me to show you my God? I'll show you. Okay. Let's make a deal. When? Let's have a date. 12 o'clock in the middle of the day. Right? Are you willing to come? We'll go outside, both of us, and I will show you my God. And Caesar says, yeah, are you sure? 12 it is. And he came at 12 o'clock. When the sun in Jerusalem, the sun was burning. At the time, it was Rome was in charge. I mean, even though we had a governor in Judea and everything, but we were under the yoke of the Romans. So therefore, Rabbi Yehoshua ben Hanania in Jerusalem was the one who had to obey what the Caesar is saying, the emperor of Rome. So he took him at 12 o'clock. Well, show me, I am ready to see your God. Where is he? So the rabbi said, can you look at the sun? It's right in the middle of the sky, at 12. And the emperor said, what? Right there? Yeah, go ahead, look at the sun. He pointed at the sun. And the emperor went like this. I can't see, I can't look. How do you mean you didn't look? You cannot see him. So the rabbi says, what? You cannot see him? You mean to tell me that you cannot even see one of his little slaves? I mean, the son is only, he's only a little slave of God. If you cannot see his slave, how do you pretend that you can see him? So it's your fault if you cannot see him. You cannot even look at one of his servants. Because the sun and the moon and the stars and everything that make this nature perform its work, it's only that the fact that they are servants of the Lord. But he himself, he cannot see, since you cannot even see his servants. And that's how he convinced him that our God is not to be seen. It's impossible, like with Enlo Guf, Enlo Demuta Guf. He doesn't have a corporal shape that we can see, because our corp, our body, we are limited by the body. I mean, you have a body, right? As beautiful as can be, whatever you want. It's a great machine, no question about it. It's a beautiful machine. Yes, that is true. There is no scientist that can invent a more beautiful machine than the body. But still, you have to admit that we are very, very limited in that body. The body comes to limit first our sight, our eyesight. How much do we see? You can see just as far as you can see. But I want to see what's going on at the end of the world. You can't. You can see just that long, that far. More than that, you cannot see. But who can see more than that? You have to know that the baby, when he is in the womb of his mother, inside the womb of his mother, our sages said that he can see till the end of the world. Which means there is such a thing, there is such a possibility to see beyond what we can ever see. So what makes us see then only 2% of what of the whole potential that we have in our eyes? Only 2%. That's all we can see. Why is that? Because we are contained in a storage, in a body. Same thing also with the ears. How far can you hear? Even if you have an excellent earring. But how far? Maybe 1 mile. More than that you cannot hear. Oh, it means that there is a limit to what I can hear. But what gives me this limit? The body. Because when the time comes for the body to go back to the grave and the neshama is out of the body, the neshama has no boundaries. Has no limits. The neshama can see from here till the end of the world. She can see through things. She can see. She can hear anything till the end of the world. So you see that Hashem, when He gave us a body, He meant to limit us. He gave us a Torah with which we can contend in accordance with our limitations that are provided and allowed only by a body such as the one that He created in us. That's the reason, if you remember in one of the old lectures, why God created us from the earth. Not here, somewhere else. Why God created us from... Couldn't He choose a better matter from which He can create us? Why did He take only dust from which He created us? You know, that's how He created Adam. Because He wanted us to be physical, to be earthly. And thus, He puts us in this world to do the job that we came here to perform in accordance with our limitations and our physicality. And physicality means earthly. And earthly means that you came from the earth. And that's the reason why we bury a body. Why? Because the function of the body has come to an end. It goes back to the earth. Maybe to recycle itself for another reincarnation. It is possible. But that's already not our business. It's the business of God. But the real you and me, the real person is what's in you, not what is carried by your body. What's in you is the neshama. And the neshama has no limit. It is limited. The neshama is the one that gives us the power to see. Without neshama you cannot see. How do I know that? I mean, take a corpse of a human being. He has eyes, but he cannot see. He has ears, he cannot hear. He has a nose, he cannot smell. He has a mouth, but he cannot speak. So it means it's not the eyes really that cause us to see. There is a power behind the eyes, an energy that comes from the neshama, the soul that cannot die. And therefore, if it is because of the neshama, so the neshama is the one that provides me with all these possibilities, only it is limited because the body condenses this energy and we can see only that much. And also this is Retzon Hashem. This is what Hashem wants. He doesn't want us to see more because we will not be able to survive. He doesn't want us to hear more than we can because we cannot survive. He does not want us to remember till the end of time because we cannot survive if we remember everything. That's the reason why Hashem created us with the forgetfulness. Forgetfulness, while it is known as a curse, but it is a great blessing. Without it, one will never stop from mourning his beloved ones who departed this world and so forth.
Or having children.
Right? That's right. So, therefore, you're right, Malkiel. I mean, the woman herself, when she gives birth, she's in such pain that she promises she'll never give birth again. Right? But that's the reason why our sages said that she has to bring a korban in the time of Beit HaMikdash. Because of this, in the fact that she took an oath, she swore not to get pregnant anymore. And yet after a few weeks, she forgets completely. Because that has been lessened, that feeling has subsided, and now she's ready for another child. That's the reason, that's one of the best reasons why Hashem wanted us to forget. You understand? So you see that we are limited in a body that is limiting us. So but if you remember that only what's inside the body, That great prisoner in our body, that's us. Not the body. The body is only a container, a storage room to which we owe respect. No question about it. We have to take care of that body. We have to give it all. We have to go to doctors and everything to take care of our health. Never to ignore the body. The Torah says, "V'nishmartem me'od lenavshotechem." You have to protect well your soul, because the soul is in distress when it is in the body. But if you give it a body that is healthy, the neshama can survive for the few years that she comes to live in that body for that lifespan in this world. Right? But the real person is not the body. We are being carried by a body. Because we need the body to perform the mitzvot. That's what Hakamim say. Without the body, you cannot do the mitzvot. How can you put tefillin? Without the body, can you put tefillin? Hashem wants us to put tefillin. Therefore, He gave us a body. Did you think about this? Huh? How can you put tefillin without... Don't worry, ladies, you don't have to put tefillin. That's your prerogative. Your prerogative that you don't have to put tefillin. If your husband puts tefillin, that's it. Very good. It's like if you put tefillin yourself. And automatically, with every mitzvah that we have, we need our hands, we need our feet, we need our rosh, our everything. That's why we need a body. But the true person is inside. When the time comes from the body that he finishes his mission in this world and he goes to the grave, the neshama is all there. Then she can see beyond whatever we can see. Then we can see things that are unbelievable. You know, let me tell you something. How many things remain unanswered in this world? So many questions, and we don't know the answer. So many questions. Do you know what happens? Of course, depending on your profession, you know the answers to this kind of profession. The other one doesn't know what you know. The other one knows what the other guy doesn't know. And that's how it goes, right? When you're a doctor, I don't know many things that the doctor does, but he doesn't know also what I know when it comes to Torah and things like this. I know about the riding, the other knows about how to make a shoe, and so forth. But questions will remain for everybody till the end of the world. And we leave this world with questions that were never answered. Well, I have a good information to share with you. When we go to the other world, immediately we understand, we know the answer to all the questions. Every question that bothers you regarding dreams or regarding what is the source of them. For example, I can tell you all the explanations about the dreams that you want. But I will never be able to explain to you, why is it that we dream? What makes us dream? What causes this kind of visions that we have when we are asleep? I can just tell you all kinds of things. But I will never know the reality of the dream. But when we go up there, after we depart from the body, after 120, hopefully, we will immediately know the nature of everything and the reason behind everything. Why? Because the neshama has no limit. She can see as far as the end of the worlds, not only the world, but all the world. She can hear from here till Gan Eden, and she can understand everything that for us it will take us at least a billion years in order to understand. For her it takes a fraction of a second. That's the reason why the guy wanted to see God. Want to see God? God made us. God created us. How can you see Him? That means you want Him to have a body? You see, this talk is important for the second commandment, by the way. Rome and Babylon and Persia, all the ancient kingdoms, all of them were permeated, steeped to the neck with Avodah Zarah, with idols, and all kinds of gods, with all kinds of shapes. Why? Why is it that they needed those shapes? Because they had to believe in something. So therefore they saw in the world all kinds of powers and energy. And they thought that every one of them, it could be a god. That was the mistake that even Avraham Avinu did. If you remember, if you recall one of the lectures in the past, that Avraham kept looking for God, thinking that the moon is the god. And then in the morning there is no moon, so it's not God. So it has to be the sun. And the sun comes to an end at the end of the day. It's not God. So who is the god? It took him 75 years to realize, for God Himself to appear before him. Because he insisted. He never gave up. If we never give up like Avraham Avinu, God will appear to us. But by the way, God appears to us every day, every minute. But that already is a matter of belief, and that's what we are learning in the first commandment. Anochi Hashem Elokecha. The emperor of Rome wanted to see a God with a corpse, with a physiognomy. He could not understand that there is a God that you cannot see. So the rabbi gave him a good answer. You want to see him? Look at the sun. He couldn't look at the sun in the middle of the day. So he said, cannot look at his servant. You want to look at the boss himself? It's impossible. But in reality, the real answer is that if God had a shape or a body, he would be limited. And God is not limited in anything. He is beyond any limit. Therefore, he is not corporal. He does not have a body. That's why. Why? Because he is unlimited. The body is only for the purpose to limit us. So this discussion is one of the ways how to gain faith. Because Harambam says that the first commandment, even though it appears to be like a statement, but it is a commandment. Why is it? It's a statement. He says, I am God, your God. Where is the commandment? The commandment is that everybody is under the obligation to do everything he can to gain faith. Don't stay with the same level of your faith. It is your obligation to aggrandize your faith in God. Yes, everybody will tell you, we believe that there is a God. Others will tell you, yes, our God is the God of Israel. As we say every day, Shema Israel, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. Fine, every Jew knows that. But we want also to understand and believe, like if you see him. It should, you know what is the highest level of faith? Is that if you, without seeing God, without seeing him, it's like if you see him. Exactly. That is a very high level. It's not easy for us. We can only assume, we can only think, we can believe. But exactly like if you see him. If God himself would come here right now. He is here. But let's say you would see him. Of course, everybody would be terrified. No one will move. No one will do anything, right? Well, at least think of him on the day of Yom Kippur this way, that he is with us. Are we on that level? Far, far from that level. But the obligation is, according to the Rambam, is at least in accordance with our level and intellect. We have to try to learn all kinds of ways how to gain faith that Hashem is our Hashem. The first indication is, as I told you, the Bible says, state which God? The God who took you out from Egypt. And I just told you that every Jew is convinced that he is a Jew who came out from Egypt. Otherwise, why does he celebrate Pesach? Why does he read the Haggadah, the story of Egypt? Here is one first indication that there is no question about it, that there is a God, and that this God is the God who took us from Egypt. But you see, human beings, it's not enough for them. They still have to be convinced again and again. So therefore, they have to learn how to have faith in Hashem. So now the question of tonight is this. How do we believe? How can we reach a certain level of belief? Isn't this a good question? How do we gain belief? That at least when I say I believe in God, I know what I am saying. Never forget what I told you, the first indication. Pesach. Pesach. You celebrate Pesach, then you know you are a Jew. Then you know that your forefathers were Jews and they came out from Egypt. That we were slaves. If we were slaves in Egypt and the creation of the Jewish people was made at the mountain of Sinai immediately after the liberation from Egypt, then the rest is only history. The rest is only 100 years after 100 years, and one gives it to the other, and then one gives it to the other, and so forth. Exactly like it says in the book of Devarim, at the end of the Torah, it says, in Parashat Ha'azinu, She'al avicha v'yagedcha, zekenecha v'yomru lach. You have any suspicion? You have any questions on your faith? Ask your father, and ask your grandfather, they will tell you. So you might come and say, what kind of expression is this? I should ask my father? My father doesn't know as much as I know. Maybe he doesn't know that much. Maybe my grandfather doesn't know. Besides, this should be enough. Yes. You want to know why? Because it's very simple. If you have a father, that means your father has a father. And that means that his father has a father. And each one, all he did was to transmit his tradition from one to another. So the Torah says, ask your father. And ask maximum your grandfather, and you will find out where is the truth. You want to know why? Not because they are smarter than you, but because they have also a father, that the one that you didn't see. And he had a father. And all of them had the same tradition, and all of them read the same Haggadah, the same story, without any alterations throughout the centuries, the same thing. Don't you think it is a clear-cut indication that we were there once in Egypt and liberated from Egypt, and therefore God himself has appeared to us at the mountain of Sinai? But as I said before, even though what I just said is enough to have everything in that faith, no question about it, but human beings are human beings, and this will not be enough. Even though it's a fact, it's a reality. I mean, you do say the Haggadah. Why do you say the Haggadah? Because I was once a slave in Egypt. Yeah, maybe not. We don't say it.